Mr. Tandon.
And my dear friends, first of all, my apologies for being so late. Actually, I was to host an international delegation and they kept on enjoying the lunch. And because I was the host, I had no options. So my apologies once again. As Mr. Tandon said, we worked together in a committee and shared some of the thoughts. That probably prompted him to invite me to this August gathering and share some of my thoughts. What you are discussing in this session is probably relevance of Gandhi's to higher education principles. Some of you who belong to Delhi might be knowing, I was the founder vice chancellor of IP University and was there 10 years. And when I founded the university, I remember it was supposed to be a professional university, and one of my first mission statement was that we will provide 3H education. And what I meant by 3H education is where the student uses head, heart and hands, all three together, then only we will be able to successfully contribute as citizens to make a difference. If head, heart and hands are not simultaneously learned to be used by the students or the graduates, then somewhere we are making some shortcomings. So with this background, I was just recollecting whatever little knowledge I have about the great man Gandhiji. I remembered an old, very old education philosopher who said education really needs three subjects only: music, mathematics and gymnastics. Said music for training of heart, math for training of mind, and gymnastics to keep you fit. So if you can be good in these three, then you have practically done everything in life. I really like that quote, but I was trying to feel whether Gandhiji, with the knowledge of that quote or without the knowledge of that quote, was not practicing this. When I learn about, when I reflect about his things, if he thinks that everybody should be mentally alert, he makes all of us mentally alert by giving his ideas, and ideas in a way which cannot be done away with, whether he is in India or South Africa or wherever, but he makes ideas which make people think. When he feels people are sleeping over, he thinks of Gandhi March. Now awake everybody, make everybody walk, make them fit. See, these were probably the methods for these great people to make sure that things happen. Looking to the relevance of the small-scale industry at that time for this country, he said everybody should use a spinning wheel or something, because that was the small-scale industry that day. I personally do not think, had he been today here, he would still say use chadha only. But probably he only meant that the industry which suits us, the industry which is more conducive to local environment, will be the industry which will take the world upwards, and particularly this country. So, and today we are talking about all these things in different concepts. As Professor Tandon just said, we are reinventing the wheel in many cases. The lunch which I hosted for the foreign delegation just now, they gave us a lot of items to eat, and then they gave us an item which they say is de-taster. I said, what nonsense, firstly we pay for tasting and then we pay for de-tasting. And you know, this is what we are probably trying to do: learn some wrong things, then unlearn them. And I still remember in one of the convocation addresses to a university, I say, whatever the management principles are taught to anybody today, you should learn to behave in a team, you should learn to understand the language, whether spoken or not, you should have strong determination. God probably has given all these traits to the newborn child. The day a child decides, today I must walk, he walks. Come what may. He goes down to play, and whosoever players are there, he is comfortable. He's a great team player. He plays. He understands his mother's language without a word from day one. So all the traits which are being taught today, so I again said the same thing. You firstly pay for school education for a large number of years, hefty fees, and all these skills are killed. And then you come to a management college to relearn all these skills, again paying a hefty fee. And we have so what Gandhiji was probably thinking was that all this has to be an embedded part of life, so that you don't have to formally learn these things. Actually, our higher education today is only formal learning. While it has been proven in the world that everybody's knowledge, at the end of the day, 15% is formal knowledge and 85% is informal knowledge. And unfortunately, we are concentrating more and more towards the formal knowledge, probably more and more time in the classroom, more and more time in a structured timetable, and so on and so forth. So that is probably, I think, we will have to come back to some of those things which connected education with business, with livelihood, with social service all together. That was a composite form of education. I can probably only find analogous to our Gurukul system of education, where we had a composite model of education. Similarly, Gandhi's obviously he worked more on primary education, he wrote, not on higher education, but concepts are equally relevant. He said everything should be self-reliant, should be complete in itself. And I was recollecting, in this country, India only, the first management college which we started in Calcutta was called Tata Institute of Social Welfare and Business. So we were very strong in trying to connect business with social welfare, not disconnecting the two. But as we went along, we probably disconnected, and now we think the CSR must be introduced, so that business people learn how to be social worker, and so on and so forth. But had we kept those concepts, probably these so-called new concepts were not required if that life would have gone through. Mr. Tandon is more than right that farming, for example, we had organic farming, then we went to chemical, more and more chemical. And now we pay double for the organic farming because we killed organic farming. Had we not killed it, nothing would have happened. And now I was reading, what we have to do is use the latest technology, but still come to the smallest unit. I was reading a case study, I think from Netherlands, that using the latest concept of Internet of Things, some of you might have heard IoT, Internet of Things, make a GPS for every plant. And they did an experiment, produced crop 2.5 times more than the earlier crop by using latest technology, and no chemical fertilizers, and just 10% consumption of water. Now, there's nothing against the latest technology, but the latest technology has to be used at the local level for the welfare of the society in that time. So once we do that, then probably we are really making Gandhiji really live amongst us, right. And we are also being fortunate in his company if we do that. And local variations have to be respected. Again, Dr. Tandon, language, why should we have the same language for education for everyone? Everybody be free to learn in the language which will be most comfortable with. One psychologist said, written, I remember, he said the best language for creativity for anybody is the language in which you dream. The language in which you dream is the language where you can be creative. And I think none of us have ever dreamt in a foreign language. And that is the language of creativity, because that is the original thinking happened, subconscious mind. So unless we sort of, and Gandhiji always said this language or not that language, he says whatever is relevant to the local needs, go ahead and do that. And knowledge industry is a one-way system. Yes, we made it one-way system, unfortunately, and we are paying the price for it today. Again, if we look to the learning models of this country, dance was probably never learnt in formal colleges and schools. We had gharanas working for generations to produce the best dancers. Music was never learnt in formal schools, but gharanas were there for generation to generation to produce the best musicians. And I prepared a report for STEM education just a few months ago on behalf of the Vivekananda International Foundation, which is just two buildings away from this building. And one of the recommendations we made, we are producing science graduates who have good grades in science, but they don't know science. They cannot practice science. And one of the examples, if some of you are science students, I gave is very interesting. A case study was done, and students were asked, what is the chemical formula of steel? And nobody answered, because no book gives the chemical formula of steel. No teacher teaches the chemical formula of steel. Then the students were invited for a discussion in a room like this. Then they were asked, what is the chemical formula of water? Everyone said, H2O.
Yes.
They said, when water boils, what happens? Steam. I said, is boiling a physical phenomenon or chemical phenomenon? Physical, sir. Do the chemical properties change during a physical process? No, sir. Now, if formula of water is known to you, H2O, you know when it boils, it forms steam. You also know boiling is a physical process, and you are also telling me chemical properties do not change during a physical process, then why can't you tell me that the chemical formula of steel is also H2O? So these are the gaps we have created because we are making the students pass the exam, not learn the subject. We are disconnecting from the subject also, not only from the society as Rajesh ji said, but we are really disconnecting them even from their own subject. So one of the recommendations we have made there is probably we have to develop science as scientific gharanas or culture, where you learn by doing, learn by listening, learn by doing. So I definitely feel whatever Gandhiji said at that time, whatever his books are available, are all relevant today, probably more relevant than even at that time. And the sooner we practice them, the better it will be for us. With these words, I thank Professor Tandon and the team for giving me an opportunity for interacting with this very committed gathering. I saw some of the topics, some of the articles. I mean, many of you have spent 10 years making a study and presented here. I think the world will be grateful to you for all your studies, which will help us. And I thank them for giving me the time to spend a few minutes with you, and I once again apologize for what I cannot do, but I had a dichotomy today. I must come and I could not come in time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.